Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Sarah with Sarah Plans Life, and today is another surrogacy video. Today's video, I'm going to talk about my contract. I received my contract this past week, so I thought I would kind of go over what's really in the contract and what's typical in surrogacy contracts. There's a few things different about this video. One, I'm not really going to be able to go through the whole contract. My first surrogacy, during the surrogacy review, the contract review, which is when the lawyer calls me and we go over the contract line by line, literally took over 2 hours. So there's just not enough time for me to actually go through this contract with you guys. And the second thing is I can't be too specific about what's in my contract because it would be a breach of confidentiality. And I really don't want to, you know, reveal any extra information about the dads. I don't need to reveal anything extra like that. So really, it's just going to be kind of an overview. I've got a lot of notes here. So we are just going to dive right in. So first things first, here's the contract. It is 94 pages long. Yeah, it took me a good 2 hours to read through one whole sitting of Apollo 13. It took me a good 2 hours to read through this whole thing. So what I do when I get my contract is I like to print it out because it's easier for me to read something like this if I have it in my hands and in front of me. And then I also take sticky notes, and I put, anytime I come across something that I'm like, I don't know what that means, I'll write it down on the sticky note and put it on the page so that when I have my review with my lawyer, which I did this past week, I'm able to ask him specifically each time we get to a section. I honestly didn't have very many questions this time. The contract is 10 pages longer than my last one, mainly because this time there are two dads instead of just one. So there's just a little bit of extra stuff in there about that. And then coronavirus totally has its fingers all in this contract. There is a ton of stuff in here about coronavirus and just different things to avoid. And so yeah, let's just hop in. So the first few pages, it's actually the first 4 pages here, are all definitions. It's pretty much defining every single thing. So one of the things that changed this time was the definition of act of God, which is on this page here. Says act of God shall mean an event outside human control, such as a pandemic, a hurricane, sudden floods, or other natural disasters, which no one can be held responsible. So they added pandemic in there because who knew that that would actually be a thing that they need to define. So these whole first pages are just all definitions of everything in there, from midwife to the definition of a high-risk pregnancy, like everything. It's 4 pages. And, you know, these, I mean, they're not using a big font. So then after that, the next few pages are about the warranties and representations. Well, yeah, that's a long word. So essentially what it is it's giving definitions to what I'm actually signing in here, giving like facts about me. So like I'll read a couple here. Gestational carrier is over the age of 21 years and a citizen of the United States of America. She is legally married to James Montgomery and currently cohabitates with him. So just kind of stuff like that about me. I understand the terms of this agreement. I am entering this agreement freely and voluntarily. Just kind of stuff like that. There's also one in here for James. There's one in here for my husband. And these are about a solid page and a half of just a bunch of things like that. He has been tested and is negative for any sexually transmitted diseases, like that kind of thing. So there's one for each of us, and then there's one for each of the parents. So that's about 6 pages worth of all of that stuff. And then the next little bit in the contract is talking about communication, pretty much. It's saying that I will make sure to let the dads know within 24 hours of receiving any information about the pregnancy, essentially. So, like, after an appointment, I need to let them know within 24 hours exactly what happened at the appointment and how it went, unless they're there with me. They live far away, so they probably won't be coming to too many appointments, but I have to inform them within 24 hours what happened at the appointment, which is necessary for me, I, you know, the second I get in my car, I'm like texting a million people. I'm texting the guys. I'm texting my coordinator for the agency. I'm texting my husband because, you know, he usually doesn't come to these with me. But it is necessary to have in there to make sure that the surrogate is keeping in contact with the parents and letting them know exactly what's going on. It also says in there that they have the right to attend any appointment, essentially, because it is their baby. Now, granted, they can be, like, I can make them leave if I need to discuss delicate things with my midwife, but in essence, they are allowed to come. Granted, they live far away, but it says that I can, you know, if they want to attend by Zoom or WhatsApp or any of those kind of apps, I do need to allow them to do that because it's their baby. Like, I don't know. I don't see that being a big deal. I mean, I've given birth 3 times now. I could be butt naked in there and I really don't care. And then the next few pages talk about medical screening, kind of what is supposed to happen at that appointment, that I'm allowing myself to be tested for STDs and communicable diseases, and that my husband is allowing himself to be tested, and that the dads are also tested as well. Like, I'm not just entering into this with just randos. They are also tested and screened, and there's also a section right after that about psychological evaluations, a psych eval for me, a baby one for my husband, and then one also for the parents, just to make sure that everyone is entering this knowing what's going to happen. I know that this is not my baby. I know I am not taking this baby home. That kind of thing. And then there's some more stuff in there. And then the next one is, we're on page 23 now. That's how far into it we are, and that's how much stuff we've discussed. Everything is a lot of flowery language, and if they can't come to the appointment, then she needs to be able to let them know that, you know, that they can come to the appointment. If it's an emergency appointment, she needs to let them know as soon as possible. Like, there's so many, like, variants with everything. It just cracks me up. Anyway, the next one is about the transfer itself, kind of talking about how many embryos we're going to transfer, and I keep looking down because I have my contract here. It also is talking about how many transfers we are willing to do under this contract. So the contract says we are doing 3 transfers before we are allowed to just, you know, cancel the contract. Now, it does say in there that we can add an addendum if we do want to do more than 3 transfers, but it kind of has that in there as a, like, okay, we're all agreeing that we're going to try at least 3 times before, you know, we just say, okay, this just isn't going to work. Now, it also says in here, I think it's farther back, that we can cancel this contract at any time as long as I'm not pregnant or in the middle of a cycle. And that's just so that, you know, if I'm suddenly like, crap, you know, I just can't do this anymore, I can cancel if I want to. And same with them. If they are like, gosh, you know what, this is just scary, we're not ready, anything like that, they can cancel and no one will be in trouble, essentially. And so then the next section is about the selection of the doctor or midwife. So essentially, I'm allowed to pick whoever I want. There is kind of a, when you're matching, you will let the parents know, like, hey, I plan on using a midwife, because some people are not comfortable with that. They would prefer an OBGYN, and that is their prerogative. That's totally their choice. However, that's why when you're matching, you say, hey, I'm using a midwife. She's going to be, you know, she's going to be out of a hospital still. You know, we're not having a home birth. We're not having a birth center birth. We're going to be in the hospital. But I would prefer to use a midwife. And most couples are totally okay with that because midwives are still very competent. And then if my pregnancy were to ever become high risk, I could very easily transfer to an OBGYN care and it's not a big deal. But it is something that's in here saying that, you know, I'm choosing a midwife, but I need to make sure that I choose a midwife who's under my insurance, who's at a hospital with a level 3 NICU, because those safeguards are in there for the parents. Like, I can't just pick a midwife that we're going to have to pay out of pocket for. I have insurance. That's not fair to them to have to pay out of pocket for a midwife when I could very easily find a midwife or a doctor under my insurance. I mean, you know, it's just fair. But I checked into my midwife and all of that info before I ever did this. So, you know, I went into this knowing my midwife takes my insurance, and, you know, if a parent isn't comfortable with me using my midwife, that's not a big deal. They can pick a different surrogate and I can pick different parents. Okay, and then one of the next things in here is about the delivery. And that, my friends, is over 2.5 pages about the delivery. And it's even longer this time because of coronavirus. So essentially what this is saying is I have the right to select who is in the room with me. I need to notify the parents as soon as possible when I go into labor so that they are able to be here for the birth. I am allowed to choose whoever is in the delivery room, but the parents do have a right to be there, so I should take that into consideration, I guess. I don't know. I can't imagine why I would ever be like, nah, I don't want you in there. Because, you know, you just gotta let it all hang out when you're giving birth. Let's be honest. It's a mess. But then there's also provisions in here, mainly that has to do with the OR, but because of coronavirus, it is now part of that, where it's like, if only one person is allowed in the delivery room or in the operating room, the, you know, surrogate has the right to choose whoever she wants. And more than likely for me, it would end up being James, because if I was in the OR, it would mean I was having a C-section. It would be my first C-section, and it would be scary, and I would want him there. That is my right, and that is my choice. However, who knows what'll happen? You know, I could have one of the dads in there. Or if, which hopefully would be preferred, if they allow at least 2 people in there, then I can have my husband and I can have one of the dads in there too. That's what I would prefer. I would prefer for one of them to be there because this is their child being born and it is a huge moment. It's a very exciting moment. But they kind of have that in there too because a lot of hospitals are restricting the amount of people in there because of coronavirus. Now, I know some hospitals, mine included, are being a little more loosey-goosey with it with surrogacies because there's just a lot that's going on with that. So a lot of the times they are allowing the dads or parents and the surrogate's husband as well. So that's what's happening right now. So in a perfect world, everyone's allowed in there. A lot of the times this is what happens when I match too, is I tell them, I'm like, hey, if you want your sister's brother-in-law's cousin's nephew to be in there, that's fine. Whatever. Whoever you want in there with you to celebrate the magical moment. Most of the time, these parents just want themselves in there. But I'm always open to just, yeah, whoever. Come watch. It's a fun time. I have no modesty anymore. All right. And then obviously I've skipped a few things in here. One of the next sections in here is called Lifestyle Prohibitions, and this is a good 5 pages. And what it is essentially, you know, the surrogate will refrain from drinking more caffeine than what is recommended by her midwife or OBGYN. The surrogate will refrain from eating raw foods, from some of the fish too, like swordfish and mackerel and stuff like that. There's a nice big section in here on coronavirus, if we find out we've been exposed, to let the parents know right away and to quarantine and, you know, just taking precautions. And this isn't telling me like what I'm allowed to do in terms of like, you know, day-to-day life, but it's essentially in a lot of flowery language saying, you're pregnant, take care of yourself, don't do something stupid. Which I would hope, you know, that any surrogate would treat this pregnancy as if she was pregnant with her own child and being extremely careful. Granted, when I'm pregnant as a surrogate, I've realized that I'm even more careful because it's not my child, and it's like, oh my gosh, it would be horrific if I messed up someone else's child. If I messed up my own child, it's like, oh, okay, that sucks, I'm dumb. But like someone else's child, oh Lord, I want to make sure I do not mess this kid up. I want to make sure this kid grows perfectly. There's a whole section in here about abstaining from sex. Mainly just, you know, they don't want me to get pregnant with my husband's kid. You know, which, duh. Like, parents are paying a lot of money for this, for me to just go and mess it up by getting pregnant on my own. Like, that's ridiculous. So what they're saying is, you know, they don't want me to have sex right before the transfer and right after the transfer, for obvious reasons. Then there's also a good section here about travel. Making sure I'm not traveling out of the state after, I believe it's 28 weeks at the start of the third trimester. Granted, right now in this time, no one's really traveling anywhere because of coronavirus. But there's also, at the bottom here, a section of states that I am not allowed to go to. And what those states are states that are not surrogacy friendly. So say I go to, what is one of them? I believe Arizona is one of them. Yes, so if I go to Arizona and I'm 28 weeks pregnant and I go into labor, or I have some complication and I have to be on bed rest in Arizona until I have the baby. Because I'm in a state that is not surrogacy friendly, what would happen is this baby would be essentially mine. They would not honor our contract. They would not see the dads as the parents of this child, even though this child is not biologically related to me at all. And what would happen is I would have to be put on the birth certificate and they would have to adopt their own child from me. And it's just a mess. And it sucks, you know, obviously it sucks. Like, oh, okay, you know, I can't go to these states. That's kind of a bummer. But it's something you know going into this. Like, if someone's reading a contract as a surrogate and is surprised by these, they need to do more research. Because this is something that is very common and not changeable. Like, you just can't change it. And that's that. There's a good 4 pages about termination stuff. I'm not really going to talk about that because that is very personal between me and the dads. So, just know that there's information about termination in here. And then there's a section here about escrow, which is where they keep the money that is used for the surrogacy, just about when it's funded and things like that, just money stuff. And then also insurance things too, just kind of saying, you know, I agree to keep my insurance throughout the whole pregnancy, my insurance through James's job. So if James were to get fired through no fault of his own, if he gets furloughed, you know, coronavirus, then, you know, the dads agree to pay for either for me to keep a, what's it called, COBRA insurance, or to get me a new insurance off the marketplace. If James were to voluntarily leave his job, say to get a new job, then I would need to make sure my new insurance either covers surrogacy, or I would need to find a different insurance that does cover surrogacy, and I would need to pay for it myself, because this is something that we chose to do voluntarily. So there's that. And now we're about halfway through. Okay, so after all of the insurance and escrow information, there's a section in here about like custody of the child and stuff like that. And what that really means is, you know, this is the parent's child. The baby will go directly to them. I'm not going to like keep the baby for a few days and then give the baby to them. Like, the baby goes from me to dad's. And then there's also a little section in here about, like, breast milk and pumping. Just kind of, I agree not to breastfeed the child unless we all agree that I can breastfeed the child. So I breastfed my last surrogate baby for a couple days while we were in the hospital. And then, obviously, once we were discharged, like, I wasn't going to his condo every day to breastfeed the baby. But I was pumping for the baby. So that's something that we will discuss and decide between us. It's a very personal decision for them, whether or not they would rather just formula feed the baby in the hospital, whether they want me to pump and give them milk in the hospital and then afterwards, or if they want me to breastfeed in the hospital and then pump for them afterwards. Like, that's totally their decision. They're the parents. They get to choose what they want to do. After this surrogacy, I do plan to pump because I really enjoyed pumping for the milk bank that I pumped for. And so if they decide they don't want any breast milk, then I will sell it to the milk bank. Okay, so the next part in the contract here is about termination and breach of agreement. So termination of agreement would be if I'm not pregnant and we decide that we just want to stop doing transfers and stop trying, that's a, you know, termination, and that's fine. But there's also breach of agreement, kind of what happens if I mess up and do something wrong, or if they do something wrong, or, you know, just kind of what happens in that case. So there's just lots of flowery language about that. And then there is a whole page in here about confidentiality and non-disclosure. So it talks in here about the fact that I cannot post pictures of them on Facebook or pictures of the baby on Facebook without their explicit permission, which, yeah, it's their child, it's their faces, you know, like, that's just common sense. but I'm glad it's in here because some people will do that. It says that I can talk broadly about surrogacy and the whole process, which is what I have been doing here and in my other videos, is I can talk broadly about it. I don't use any, you know, specific kind of terminology about the dads. I don't use any specific locations or anything like that because I want to keep their identities confidential. You know, if they don't want to tell the child anything about me, that is their right and their decision. So it is not my business or my right to talk about them and reveal their identities or talk about specific details about this process, because it is not just my life that's in this. It is my husband's life. It is their lives. It is their child's life. And yeah, so I totally agree with this, and that is why I am being very vague with a lot of this stuff. Okay, that confidentiality page was on page 64, so we're getting there, guys. So essentially, after that, there's a few other things in here. But then after that is really, that's the end of the bulk of the language part of the contract. So what we get to after that is the notary pages. So each of us adults in this, so the two dads, James, and myself, we each have a page in here that needs to be signed and notarized by a notary. This is like our official signing of the contract. And then there's also at the bottom of the page, our initials. So at every single page in here, we have to initial saying that, you know, obviously we've read and we understand each page. So it's a lot. That's why I say like signing these contracts is tedious, because you have to initial 94 pages of paperwork and you have a page that you have to sign as well. And then right after the notary pages is pretty much the start of the money stuff. Detailing, you know, how much I'm making, how much I make if I end up carrying twins, how much I make if, God forbid, I have to have a DNC, transfer, all of that stuff. If you were curious about like the actual money things of most surrogates, a lot of the agency pages post what the surrogates get paid. This is something I am also not going to reveal, not because, you know, I'm like shy about the fact that I make money. Like, you know, I am doing this because I really want them to have a family. But I'm not gonna lie and say that I'm not excited about the money part too. This is going to be really great for my family. We're going to be able to go on, you know, more vacations from this money. We're gonna be able to extend our patio. Yes, I am doing it out of kindness and I'm very excited for them. You cannot be a surrogate and just be doing it for the money. It is a lot of hard work. However, it is also financially beneficial for me as well. It is nice to be able to bring in extra money, to be able to pay off our credit cards and our cars. It's very exciting to be helping these guys have a child. That's very exciting for me. It's very cool. Like, I love my kids, and I want other people to be able to experience that love with their own kids. So, yeah, so my agency is Simple Surrogacy. So if you want to go to their website, it's simplesurrogacy.com, and they have all of the financial stuff detailed out there for surrogates to see and for the parents to see, you know, what they're paying for. One thing in here that I will talk about is it's called a non-accountable allowance. And what that is a monthly fee that I receive that's kind of just thrown out there for miscellaneous surrogacy things. And that pays for any kind of miscellaneous stuff, for mileage to my local appointments, for childcare for my appointments, for prenatal vitamins, for postage. If I need to send them sonogram pictures or anything like that, it pays for the postage for me to send that to them. Yeah, so that pretty much is kind of like a miscellaneous. I don't need to save all my receipts for prenatal vitamins and stamps and stuff like that. Like, that's just what that fee kind of pays for. I also use it for monthly prenatal massages. As long as it's okay with my midwife for me to get prenatal massages, I use that allowance to get that, to help me relax, to help me stay in kind of good shape for being pregnant. So another thing in here is about pumping and fees for pumping. So it pretty much says in here that they will, if they want me to pump milk for them, they will pay for my supplies to be able to pump milk for them. Now, typically my insurance pays for a pump, pays for a pump, a pregnancy. So I you know, my insurance will pay for a new pump, so they won't have to worry about that. But kind of the random things that come with pumping, so like new bottles. Granted, I buy super cheap ones from Walmart because I am an overproducer and I need big bottles. So those are like a dollar each. But then like flanges and stuff, things that don't carry on from pregnancy to pregnancy because they tend to wear out. Most of that stuff is not very expensive. I would pay for like pumping bras and stuff like that because even though those are a necessity, those are very expensive and it feels kind of weird to ask them like, hey, can you pay for my pumping bras? Like, ugh, I don't know. They don't even pay for that. That's something for me and for my comfort. So, and I already have a bunch, so I really won't even need them to pay for any. It also details like how much they would pay per ounce for my milk. So for this contract and with the milk bank, it is $1 an ounce, which I think is very fair because it is a lot of hard work. I did not realize the last time how much hard work goes into exclusively pumping, especially when you are an oversupplier like me. I had a very large supply. Towards the end, once I started weaning, I was pumping about 90 to 100 ounces a day, which is enough to feed 2.5 kids. It's a lot. It's very uncomfortable. It means I have to pump often to relieve, and it is a lot of work. So I find that compensation very fair. There are a lot of women who donate their breast milk for free, and I think that's great for them. I think if they feel compelled to do that, they are more than welcome. I donated milk a little bit. I had a few neighbors who needed breast milk, and I was like, here's 40 ounces. Bye-bye. But in massive amounts, it is a lot of work. We ended up having to buy an actual freezer that was just for breast milk because I was producing so much and I was not getting it out the door to the milk bank fast enough. Crazy. A lot of work. And yeah, that's essentially it. On the last page, there's a thing in there that I added for this surrogacy compared to my last one, and that is for chiropractic care. I noticed last time that I really benefited from chiropractic care, but I had not used it before, and so I didn't feel comfortable asking for that to be paid for when I had never used it for my previous pregnancies. But now that I have used it, I can't imagine not having chiropractic care during pregnancy. It made my pregnancy so much more comfortable and so much more bearable. So I put in here that I would like, although the contract is a little more vague about it, but I had specified saying, you know, I would like, I can't remember if I said one or two chiropractic appointments a month and that I would pay for the rest. But in here it just says, just they'll pay for my chiropractic care. So I'm just going to, in my head, you know, only bill for one or two of those a month because I feel like after that it's just, I don't know, it's just excessive and I can use my non-accountable allowance for the rest. And yeah, that's my contract, guys. And I was able to do this in I think a 30-minute video, so there we go. Yeah, it's a lot, and for a lot of people it's kind of like, I can't believe you're signing this 94-page contract to carry someone else's child. And it's like, this is a very delicate and difficult process, and you want to have every safeguard in place for the surrogate and for the parents too. Like, you want to make sure that you are legally safeguarded against things like the surrogate taking the baby and just running away, which I have not heard of an instance of that happening. Most of the time when you're a surrogate, you're all done with your family, so the thought to me of keeping a child sounds awful. I don't want any more kids. I like mine. I have almost both of them in school. So exciting. I don't want to start over. It does have safeguards in there for me to make sure that this baby is legally theirs and that they are able to take the baby without me needing to sign extra things, needing to jump through hoops, without me worrying that I will have to take this baby home because I don't want any more kids. So yeah. Let me know if you guys have any questions. Get down in the comments and let me know. I love answering questions about surrogacy. I love letting people know what's going on behind the scenes. Like, this is a really, really cool process to me, and it's a really fun process, and my gosh, things are happening quick, and I am so excited for it. Hopefully we'll sign the contract in the next few days. I believe their lawyer should be sending it to them today. Today is Monday, the 13th. Today is Monday, July 13th. So hopefully they get the contract that I made revisions in, like a couple, not even big ones. They'll get that, and then if they approve it, they will sign it, and then they will scan it, send it to their lawyer, who will send it to my lawyer, who will send it to me. And then James and I will sign all our bits, send it off back to my lawyer, and then after that, the signed contract will be sent to the fertility clinic so that the fertility clinic knows, okay, there's a contract in place, let's get started on deciding on a transfer date. And that should all happen in the span of this week. So, I mean, my gosh, perfect world scenario. By the end of the week, we kind of have some tentative transfer dates planned. So exciting! So, the next video, next surrogacy video that I will probably make will be a medicine video, essentially. It'll be all of my meds that I will be taking for the surrogacy process, of kind of detail how I do my shots. Maybe I'll even do one on camera for y'all. Let me know in the comments if that's something you want to see. If not, that's fine. I know one of my IFs is like freaked out about needles, so I am sure he will not want to see that. But if anyone else does, let me know and I'll film a video. But yeah, my next video will be about kind of the medical aspect of it and all the drugs and stuff and everything that I'll have. And then the one after that, I'll probably be talking about my transfer. So thank you guys for watching this video. Please subscribe to my channel so that you can see that medicine video that I'll do all about the shots and pills that I'll have to take, and then see the transfer video. So subscribe so that you get notified when those happen. And I will see you guys in my next video. Bye-bye. Put to sleep.